Your advice to consumers is if they feel their developer is not registering the project, come to UP RERA, make your complaint.
There is no taking over of incomplete project right. as far as the RERA Act is concerned.
Right.
The first right of refusal to complete the project is given to the RWA or the Apartment Owners Association. Liquidity issue is again a very major issue which the promoters at this juncture are feeling. There is a proportion of 20 to 25% projects where today prima facie they don't appear to be cash positive.
Hi, welcome to The Property Show. I'm Jayashree Kurup. I'm editor MBTV and I have with me Mr. Rajiv Kumar. He's the regulator of the UP RERA. Welcome
Hello.
To our show, sir.
Thank you
for joining us. Today, there are a large number of consumers who rest their hopes on RERA, and this is the area where maximum number of complaints are coming up. And I think a lot of work has been done. So let's talk about some of the issues that our consumers have raised, and hopefully you will be able to fill them with some amount of hope that there are resolutions coming up. Let's talk about the first thing. You've taken a very strong stance on non-registration of projects, and some letters have gone out to developers about non-registration. Are these based on consumer complaints?
Yes, we do get a fair number of complaints which are related to the projects which are not registered with us. In addition, we have a UP RERA app. We do get some complaints that way. Plus, from all over the state, people are complaining that certain project is being done which is not registered with RERA. So there are various sources of this information, and it is important for us to ascertain whether that project needs to be registered in the first place or it does not qualify to be an ongoing project.
Right.
As is provided in the Act and the rules.
So, your advice to consumers is if they feel that their project, their developer is not registering the project, come to UP RERA, make your complaint, and the authority will take action?
Yes, that's the whole idea. That whenever a complaint comes, we put a date where all the information and evidence is available. So, we request the person who has made a complaint to provide all the backup papers
right.
so that this can be ascertained that this project needs to be
right.
registered. And the proponent also is given an opportunity if he has something to say about it.
Right. So if you are making a complaint to UP RERA, please make sure you have all your papers, the backup papers, so that the authority can also speed up its action and quickly take action on this. Sir, you are believed to be taking over incomplete projects. Help us understand what kind of projects are taken over by UP RERA and what is the next step?
I think I would like to clarify here that there is no taking over of incomplete project
right.
as far as the RERA Act is concerned.
Right.
The provisions are contained in Section 7 and 8. Section 7 says that if a project is stalled, then the promoter is given a notice of all the violations which he or the company would have done and asked to explain. There are two outcomes of it. One is that the promoter comes up with a mitigation plan and there is a provision that the authority can issue certain directions to the promoter so that the project can start moving or move ahead at a faster pace. The second alternative is that such a plan is not forthcoming, or in certain cases the promoter himself is not traceable or herself is not there. So in that cases one has to move to Section 8 which requires a deregistration of the project. And at that stage the first right of refusal to complete the project is given to the RWA or the Apartment Owners Association. And in case they are not in a position to complete the project, in consultation with the state government, an alternative arrangement would be made.
So the problem is that many developers have actually siphoned out money out of the project, right? And even if you give it back to the consumers, they have probably paid in many cases up to 95% of the cost. So raising those resources to complete the project seems to be one of the biggest.
You are right that in case there is a project where substantial amount of money has been taken away, in that case the project may not be totally cash positive.
Right.
We had got an audit done of 100 odd projects earlier in this area in NCR. And what we have gathered is that there is 25% projects which are on the roll, in the sense that there is no major issue, there are no major complaints, the projects are moving ahead smoothly. There are 50% or so projects where they need assistance in various ways. There may be some issues with concerning the authorities, there may be some issues relating to their extension of maps and stuff like that. So, liquidity issue is again a very major issue which the promoters at this juncture are feeling. So, those are the projects where if a promoter is willing, RERA is completely supporting them with a view to ensuring that the project gets completed.
Okay.
And the buyers get their much awaited flats.
Right.
Or plots. The third category is the one which you have mentioned, that there is a proportion of 20 to 25% projects where today prima facie they don't appear to be cash positive.
Mm-hmm.
In those cases it has to be handled on a case to case basis. There is no one size fit all kind of a solution. And in that case, I think we will have to handle it as it comes. And there may be areas where in some projects there may be an FSI which is unutilized. In some cases, there may be part of the land which can be utilized to generate some more cash.
Right.
So, those solutions have to be found out on a case to case basis. And in those worst cases where there is a complete siphoning of projects and the promoters are no longer either available for discussions or they have vanished.
Mm-hmm.
I think a police investigation to finding where the money has gone and what can be retrieved would be part of the overall solution, let's put it.
So, are consumers coming to you?
There are a number of cases where, for example, I mentioned about some of the notices which we had given for deregistration. And in a few of those cases, the money from a project has been used to buy land elsewhere. This, I would say, is a diversion, surely, from RERA's perspective. It's a full-fledged diversion because the money should have been used first to complete this project before taking out. But in case there is a tangible asset available, it's still retrievable.
Yes.
There are some cases where this money trail is not so clear. And wherever, for example, in one case the promoter said we have two pieces of land. We have taken an advance in selling off one of them. We get X amount of money which we are going to put in this project.
Okay.
And within the next 4 months, we are also going to sell off the second plot of land. And we will be able to complete this project. So, people are coming up with their own solutions. And in such cases, we are giving them a few months window before any further decision is taken, with a strict control on monitoring how this project goes in the next few months.
And the consumers are happy with waiting?
I think one thing we all have to understand is that being a new law here, there is a degree of uncharted territory which we have to go together.
Right.
And when I say together, it means wherever the buyers are there, wherever the promoters are willing, and all governmental agencies, including RERA here.
Right.
So, if everybody works together, I am sure that finding a solution is not a major deal. And that's what our endeavor is.
Right. Sir, consumers are complaining that we do get some positive judgments, but the enforcement of those judgments is often a challenge.
Yes.
Do you agree?
I think that we do need a fairly rigorous follow-up on the decisions. For that purpose, we have on our website a provision that if in the stipulated time the decision is not followed, then they can put up an execution request.
Mm-hmm.
And that is being closely followed.
Okay.
This is also true that all the orders which come through from RERAs are essentially appealable.
Yeah.
And in quite a few cases, people who are not totally in agreement with the orders mm-hmm. which have been passed, they do go for appeal.
Okay.
And that has its own time cycle.
Right.
In a couple of cases, there are stays also.
Mm-hmm.
But having said that, out of 14,444 complaints which we have received till
mm-hmm.
date,
mm-hmm.
We have been able to clear almost 60% of them by now.
Mm-hmm.
And about 5,500 only are remaining. Most of them are of recent origin.
And do these, how many of these orders would have gone through to resolution?
I think the percentage of resolution per se at this moment would be closer to 50%.
Okay.
But this is surely going to grow with time
yeah.
as the compliances improve.
And the compliances have started improving.
Compliance
right?
have started improving.
Sir, there are two other agencies that consumers tend to go to, NCDRC, NCLT, and of course the civil courts are open to them. Do you think that having a multiplicity of agencies mm-hmm. is actually slowing down the process?
I think you are aware that during the last government, two of these very revolutionary acts
yes.
were put in place. The one which created NCLT, the other one which created RERA.
Right.
So, whenever any new fora comes up,
mm-hmm.
there is a period of time when the law settles down, the boundary conditions are settled.
Right.
I think that for NCLT and RERA both, there are issues. You are aware that the home buyers were given a special status mm-hmm. by the central government,
yes.
Realizing that they can't be left out. There is sufficient financial institutions money riding on that
yeah.
out of the NCLT process. The matter in any case is under consideration by the Honorable Supreme Court at this matter. So, in due course, I am sure that by various judicial pronouncements
mm-hmm.
and maybe later on through some amendments, the boundary conditions will be more settled.
Okay.
However, as far as NCDRC is concerned, my personal view is that for projects which are not registered with RERA
mm-hmm.
or they cannot be registered with RERA, surely
mm-hmm.
there are going to be some cases where RERA's jurisdiction directly will not lie.
Like you said, when projects have been given their OC before RERA came into force.
They have been given their OCs, there are certain areas which are remedies are not specifically provided
yeah.
under RERA and
mm-hmm.
so on. So, in those cases, obviously, a buyer would look at other foras. But I am sure that in due course, the issue for registered projects, whether they are filed here or in
mm-hmm.
NCDRC, will slowly get settled.
Okay. And if five consumers have gone to NCDRC and 100 have come to RERA, and the two orders are a little different from each other,
mm-hmm.
does that make a difference?
I think, look, NCDRC's forum or the consumer forums, by and large, they are on the curative side.
Right.
While the area of operation for RERA is, I would say, for the home buyers, much wider.
Uh-huh.
The canvas for NCDRC and consumer forums is much wider because
right.
they cover all consumer
sure.
services.
Sure. Sure.
So, there is, I think, a difference between the breadth and the depth
right.
As far as the residential sector is concerned.
So how closely does RERA work with authorities to complete projects that are either held up? Sometimes there is a approval that has lapsed and things like that. Does RERA work closely with authorities?
As far as the Act is concerned, there are three key players in RERA: the buyer, the promoter, and the agent. And the powers to issue directions are strictly restricted to these three players.
Right.
Having said that, and given the kind of status of the sector and the problems we have in the NCR board, I have always maintained that the solutions are all there. But then everybody has to work together. We keep very close liaison with the authorities, be it Noida, Greater Noida, Yamuna Authority, GDA, LDA, Banaras Development Authority, and so on. We have periodic meetings with them, and we also have project specific meetings with them.
Right.
And whenever we have one-to-one meetings with various promoters or home buyers, their representatives are also there.
Sir, when a developer who had taken a very large tract of land from the authority,
mm-hmm.
and if the developer decides not to, that it is not possible in the current situation,
mm-hmm.
and returns the rest of the land to the authority, does he need RERA's approval to do that?
In case the land which the promoter is surrendering is a part of a project which is registered with RERA, then he has to update all that information,
mm-hmm.
and would require concurrence from RERA.
Right.
But if that land is part of the phase which is not yet registered with mm-hmm. RERA, then the promoter need not come to us.
Right.
Similarly, there is a provision that if they get a new developer or the project is transferred,
mm-hmm.
they again need approval of the buyers
mm-hmm.
and RERA.
Mm-hmm.
Where the project is registered.
In how many cases have you seen the co-developer model working very well?
I think as things stand, personally speaking, there are two modes which would be in operation.
Mm-hmm.
One would be, I think, a co-developer model,
mm-hmm.
where a person comes in with finances
mm-hmm.
and completes the project, and the two promoters have some arrangement to share whatever is left on the table.
So that is registered with RERA.
So if another promoter is coming there, has to be registered mm-hmm. with RERA.
Mm-hmm.
There is another model where we might call it a PMC model or a project development model,
yeah.
where another developer who has finances would not like to take the liability of
yes.
the company and have a contract which will clearly lay out the responsibilities and the duties of each of
mm-hmm.
these two players
mm-hmm.
so that the project gets completed.
Right.
And we have seen a startup of these kinds of arrangements
right.
in NCR areas and other areas also, and this trend I think will grow.
Right. It seems to be a working model for
it is a good working model, and I see in a short foreseeable future a lot more of this action happening.
So very quickly, to get some statistics from you, the total number of complaints that you received, you said, is over 14,000?
Yeah, I mean, as of yesterday, we had a registration of 14444 projects, which is 14,444. Yeah.
That's a good number to have.
Yeah.
How many of those got resolved?
So we have been able to resolve 7,500 of them.
Mm-hmm.
And I am also happy to report that we had started this conciliation system.
Yeah.
We have got almost 700 complaints where people have actually applied for conciliation.
Mm-hmm.
And I see this trend to grow in coming months.
So what happens in a conciliation model?
Whenever a person comes with a complaint on our website,
mm-hmm.
and as you are aware that UP was the first state to start an online registration
yeah.
system for complaints, there is a pop-out which asks him whether he would first like to go in for a conciliation.
Mm-hmm.
And if he agrees, then this complaint is posed to the promoter,
mm-hmm.
who within 15 days is to get back saying that he's okay with the idea of conciliation.
Mm-hmm.
And then immediately the concerned conciliator gives a time where there are representatives of the Home Buyers Association, where there are representatives from the from CREDAI and other institutions on the buyer side, plus the concerned complainant and the buyer. And there is a conciliator appointed by RERA, who is kind of a referee in this whole process.
What is the profile of a conciliator?
He is a senior officer from the state government who is retired and has almost 35 years of experience in various forums.
Yeah.
And has handled judicial work earlier.
Okay.
So, he is both on the administrative side and the judicial side.
So, out of the 700 cases that went in for conciliation,
yeah,
or have all been resolved?
They are in various stages,
yeah,
but the beginning has been made,
yeah,
and we expect this trend to grow.
Sure.
And you had mentioned about Maharashtra, I think that's the way they are,
yeah,
moving ahead,
yeah,
and that's why they have such a nice track record on resolving issues.
Right. So, what percentage of cases are there that cannot go through to resolution and have to have RERA intervention?
Actually, there is one, I would say, broad group, where a person has invested in a project based on a preset notion of returns.
Right.
Those are cases where the person is not as keen to obtain possession, as to get a money refunded with interest.
Especially so, in a weak market where
especially in a weak market.
Returns
so
are better.
This is one group where the possibilities of reconciliation are not very high.
Okay.
Though we have seen through the process that once they get a feeling that this project is close to completion, a few of them do change their minds.
Okay.
And they say, no, no, we'll take a position, it's a good location, and they see that in the overall bargain, it's a good idea to take possession and then decide what to do.
So, of the total number of cases that you have, how many of them do you think are criminal offences where the promoter has to be jailed and so on? And how often do you try to keep the promoter out of jail and complete the project?
Well, I think that's not a easy answer really.
Yeah.
But the first effort of everybody, including in UP RERA, is that if we can find a way to complete the project, that's the first priority. Because I understand that you had also recently got a survey done,
right,
on
yeah,
whether people would like to go to RERA. I
so believe over 75%, 78% of consumers said RERA is my first port of call.
Right. And there again, I mean, if I am not mistaken, there were some about 18% people who were actually looking for a refund.
Yes.
Which means that more than 80% people on an average,
yes,
are looking for a house.
Yes.
Now, if that be so, then for any organization like RERA, the priority has to represent this 82%,
yes,
first.
Yes.
While complying with the provisions of the Act. And with that perspective, the question which you had asked is, to our mind, sending somebody to jail may not really get you those flats. So unless it's a completely you give up on a person,
yeah,
and he decides that despite the long rope, he's not willing to,
yeah,
you know, take advantage of that. In those cases, strict action is required, and in fact, in a couple of cases, we have ourselves recommended to the UP state government to set up STF for investigating these cases.
Okay. Thank you so much, sir.
Thanks a lot. It's always a pleasure. Thanks.
So, there you are. There are resolutions on their way. There is an effort by many, many agencies to solve your problems. If you have a problem, come up to RERA, post your queries. Many of you have said that RERA is your first port of call. Go to the website, log your complaint, and as far as possible, try to go for conciliation. We've seen in many parts of the country, especially in Maharashtra, that resolution and conciliation and working with the developer to solve your problems seems to take the issue forward. If not, there's always RERA, which is trying to find more and more creative ways of finding the resolution so that your projects can be completed. Thank you for watching The Property Show. Please subscribe to Magic Bricks on YouTube and click the bell icon to get new videos.